Stephanie Miller mentioned Sharon Angle. That's some race in Nevada. She has been hitting hard at Mr. Reed and accusing him of living it up in Washington. Here's part of her latest ad. Watch.
Harry Reid versus Harry Reid, living large in the D.C. Ritz-Carlton. You, living in the state with the highest unemployment rate, worried about paying the mortgage. Harry Reid, making $1 million from a sweetheart land deal. You, just trying to make ends meet, wondering how you're going to take care of your family.
What do you make of that race, Mark?
Over the last year, it's been a tight race. It's been a contested race. There was a moment where we thought Harry Reid didn't have a shot to even win the thing. They're in a dogfight right now, and I think she's playing the right angle. I mean, is it completely honest? No. I mean, if you were to poll everyone in the Senate, if you were to look at every single senator on the Democrat or Republican side, they all have sweetheart deals. They all make more money than they should, and they all do less work than they should. But the fact that she's campaigning as an outsider, she's campaigning as someone who won't be business as usual, I think that's a smart strategy. The problem is she has Christine O'Donnell disease. She has Sarah Palin syndrome. She keeps gaffing. She keeps making mistakes. And she keeps exposing herself as someone who is not qualified to be the senator of the state, a U.S. senator.
She spoke to a group of Hispanic school children and said, some of you look a little more Asian.
Asian. Like, who's on her team? Who's her publicist? Who's her manager? She needs to read from a tight script. She should never freestyle, ever. This is bad. It's okay. Bad business.
Penn, but why is the leading Democrat in the Senate in such trouble, Penn?
Well, it's a bad, bad time to be the guy sitting on Larry King, who's a nut job and from Nevada. there's really no defense whatsoever to have here. I'm trying desperately to find something good to say about the people that are running in Nevada, and I can't. I think the scariest thing about Sharon Angle is that she actually seems to be having a chance against Harry Reid, which I think says so much bad about Harry Reid. I mean, people dislike him so much that we're to the point that they'll vote for anybody. And when anybody includes this woman, it's terrifying to be sitting here in Las Vegas.
Stephanie, though, Nevada is in the biggest trouble in America.
Yeah, but you know what I love about this ad, Larry, is, you know, apparently liberals are all socialists, but one of them makes it as a capitalist. Then that's a bad thing. It's like this guy worked all his life. He came from this poor background, worked as a lawyer, worked away to be the Senate Majority Leader, lives in the Ritz-Carlton, and now that's bad. Now that's bad somehow.
Stephanie,
now he's a capitalist. He's a socialist that somehow made it as a capitalist. Ben?
No, there's so many ways to attack this woman, Stephanie. Don't pick the one way you can't attack her. She's talking about it's not anti-capitalist to say the government shouldn't give a lot of money to one person. That's a whole different thing. You can attack her. You win
For
automatically.
God's sake, she wants to ban the Department of Education. She wants to ban drinking in Las Vegas.
That's all stuff to attack her for. You just happen to pick the one thing that she could kind of slide by on. She's wrong. I'm not defending her. I won't at all. I'm just saying that's not really the right thing to attack.
Doesn't that sum up the whole problem of the Democratic Party, that the majority leader is in trouble against a woman who we can
question? He's crazy.
Someone who's destined for anonymity in two weeks. Yeah, absolutely.
Yes.
This is absolutely a bad sign for the Democratic Party. And the reason why he's in such peril is not because of his own track record necessarily. It's because of the track record of the Democratic Party. People are frustrated with business as usual. People are frustrated with the fact that we had a de facto and at one point a literal supermajority and still couldn't get legislation through. And sadly, Nancy Pelosi and Harry Reid are the faces of all of the spineless, feckless Democrats who have been unable to move forward a progressive agenda. And if President Obama were on the ballot in 2010, he would also have a tough time. I'm not saying he wouldn't win, but he would also be bearing the brunt of some of this.
They've moved forward more legislation than in a generation. What are you talking about? Financial reform, health care reform, Lilly Ledbetter. What are you talking
about? There are two issues here. One issue is that they haven't done good public relations. I agree. Remember, I started this conversation by saying that the Democratic Party has made major policy advances on several fronts. But the problem is they haven't done a good job of representing that. They spend so much time on defense, talking about not being socialist, talking about the truth.
Some phone calls. David, how many admitted people who say I am in the Tea Party do you count are going to win next in 2 weeks?
Right off the bat, there's about 50 candidates on one list that I have, and we're probably looking at about 30 of them, somewhere 25 to 30 of them that are going to win. We're looking at even Real Clear Politics, which looks at a pickup and puts the Republicans at about 213 to 215. And this is why I like to sit back and listen to three people defend.
Do they have the Knicks winning the championship this year, too?
Well, Mark, if you let me finish, we'll have some facts here.
Oh.
Yes, the president has actually advanced a number of policies. Have they been the right policies? What is the job situation? What is unemployment? What is the tax structure? What is the fear of small businesses? And look, punchlines and attacks on Sharon Angle are great, but let's talk about the failures of Harry Reid. Let's talk about the failures of the policies and a country that doesn't have confidence in the leadership.
Well, we can talk about the success.
I got to get another break. We have many breaks and opinions and phone calls and lots more. Don't go away. Still, America ranks very low in the world in turnout in elections. Way down. Surprising when you hear all this rhetoric. Let's take a call. Larkspur, California. Hello.
Yes, hello, Larry. I'd like to ask a question, and if I could stay on the line to see if they give the right answer.
You mean, right or wrong? Okay, go.
I'd like to ask the panel if they know where in the Constitution we are guaranteed separation of church and state.
First Amendment, sir.
Ding, ding, ding.
No, actually, it does not guarantee a separation of church and state. All it promises is that the government cannot establish a religion for everyone in the government. It does not guarantee.
The government can establish a religion, therefore that separates the government from religion.
Right. The principle behind it is to prevent state-sponsored coercion of religious thought and freedom. I mean, that's the idea, is the state can't coerce religious practice.
Here's some, you talk about campaign rhetoric becoming heated. Here's John McCain on his fellow senator, Barbara Boxer.
Barbara Boxer is the most bitterly partisan, most anti-defense senator in the United States Senate today. I know that because I've had the unpleasant experience of having to serve with her.
What do you make of that, Stephanie?
Ouch. Wow. Just when you thought he couldn't get any crankier than during the last campaign, he's in full get-off-my-lawn mode, isn't he?
But that's the way America is getting, isn't it? Isn't that representative of what's going on?
You know, Barbara Boxer is one of our finest senators, and whatever happened to the comity of the Senate? I mean, this is, you know, unnecessarily personal. And I'm sorry, he's supporting a candidate whose whole experience is running a company into the ground, getting fired, outsourcing thousands of jobs. So, you know, for him to take on Barbara Boxer that way is
Penn, young. Why is this campaign overall so vicious? You're a good analyst of all of this, Penn. Analyze this for me.
I don't believe that it is. I believe that we've had fistfights break out in the Senate. I mean, in the country's history, things are supposed to be passionate. I mean, when it gets personal, it just gets stupid, and it hurts, I think, the person saying it more. But we always pretend that things are getting hotter and more aggressive, and I don't think there's any historical evidence of that at all.
I think they are, Penn. Even fistfights breaking out in the Senate, it's different than the kind of public skirmishes that we're beginning to see now. When you have people like Sarah Palin, for example, putting crosshairs on a map and using the sort of militaristic language of targeting areas at a moment where people are getting their offices broken into, where real violence is happening, that's a heightened kind of thing. When you see Tea Party violence, when you see violence coming from the left as well, this type of stuff is a moment that is more heated than many in American history. I think this is something that we should give pause to and not pretend that this is business as usual. It's not.
To be fair, I think it's a lot easier what John McCain said versus, say, calling someone a whore. I mean, let's be straightforward about this. Ugliness doesn't belong in politics.
It's all ugly, but it's all ugly.
No, it doesn't belong in politics.
Can you hold everyone in the country responsible for everything anyone in any campaign office says?
If you let me make my point.
He was reprimanded immediately.
If you let me make my point, Stephanie.
How much of this problem is, in fact, 24-hour news, which maybe wasn't here. Well, not maybe. It wasn't here 50 years ago. Maybe the same thing was going on in 1960 when Kennedy ran against Nixon. It just There weren't 4,600 channels talking about it.
Right. Well, it's a combination of 24-hour news. It's a combination of 24-hour news and deeply partisan news. I mean, for God's sake, the Jeremiah Wright thing happened like in February, and by June, Fox News was still running. I mean, like, Lakers win the championship, and they're still showing Jeremiah Wright clips. I mean, there's a way in which there's an attempt to shape America's conscience through the news, and that's why you see so much more of this happening now than you did before.
Right, but, and that only happens on the right, I mean, according to Mark,
what's
right?
It happens on the left and the right, David.
Okay, so is it right on the left and the
right? One at a time, one at a time.
Mark, what's with all the female Republican candidates using the term man up, man up? Man up. The president doesn't have the cojones. What's with the ball humor? Is that suddenly okay?
It's disgusting. It's uncivil.
First of all, it's not our sexual reference when used that way, Stephanie. Nice try. The fact is, what's with the left?
It's still inappropriate.
No, you know what it is?
It's still inappropriate.
There is under the surface homophobic about it.
Exactly.
No, there isn't, Stephanie.
You're not a man.
You're not a real man.
It's what they try to do to John Kerry.
Wait a minute. David Webb, are you saying on national television that there's nothing wrong with talking about the president's balls? I mean, is that actually what you're saying?
Man up is a term that doesn't have that reference anymore.
No, they say he doesn't.
No more than it does by the race baiting, which the left throws out there. And Mark, you and I have dealt with this, so don't go there.
First of all, the NAACP
lied, and a bunch of race baiters out there on the left are playing this game.
Wow, you're on a major tangent. I have no idea where you're going with this.
Mark, you referenced.
Hold on, guys. You referenced throwing bricks through buildings.
Find me the proof that was done by a TV.
I'll respond on the other side.
102. We'll be back following this message. Stay tuned, fifth graders.